architecture and science and society.
Thanks, Boris. Well, it is a huge honor for me to be here. Because I, over the last 10 years in my work, which is really, I'm a personal coach for scientists. I work with scientists, try to help them figure out what they want to say. And, out of all those scientists, Ram was Ram. He is truly one of a kind. And I really am interested here because I'm just, as people were coming in, I talked to a few of you. How many of you in this room were students of Ram at one point? Please stand up. Okay, my hat's off to you because I know you're carrying the charge forward. How many of you knew Ram in some capacity? Wow, look at that. That's quite a majority. So, Ram had a big impact. And what I'm here to talk to you about tonight is really three things. One, I want to tell you a little bit about a few Ram stories, a few behind-the-scenes stories about my time working with Ram. And I also want to talk about the bigger topic, the broader topic that Ram, in many ways, leads us into, which is this issue of why should scientists be messengers for their science? And what are the risks and rewards of doing that? And then finally, I'm going to end up with, under the auspice of Ram's rules, how can a scientist become an agent of change should you decide that you want to take up this charge? So, I was surprised Boris didn't mention that we had worked closely together because it was at the same time that I met Boris, I met Ram. And what happened was I caught wind of a presentation in 2003 that he gave at the American Fisheries Society. And I was always on the hunt for tipping point science because my job is working with scientists so that science can really get out there. And really, have an impact on the wider world. And so, when I heard about this paper that he was working on, it wasn't even published yet. But it was one that you probably heard about. Oh, sorry. It's got a weird thing come up on my computer. The ghost of Ram. So I heard about this paper and I phoned him and I was kind of nervous. I thought, how am I going to convince this scientist who doesn't even know me to work with me on communicating this paper? And I got on the phone, and within seconds, suddenly he was running ahead of me. And I captured his imagination, and he said, yes, you can work with me. We can communicate this paper, and I wanted to be like NASA. Ran with this fascination with NASA, because they were so successful in making the world care about the work that they were doing and supporting it. And in fact, today, when I had lunch with Rita, she told me this story about how Ram would, introduce himself and say, hi, I'm Ram. That stands for Ransom Aldrich Myers. It's an acronym, like NASA. And that was Ram. I mean, he was a rocket ship of unrivaled energy and passion. And my job often was to say, well, Ram, okay, let's just figure out how to tone that down a little bit for this particular audience. And here we are, collaborating on a talk he was about to give. He's all energy and zeal, and I'm saying, well, let's just think about how we should say that. The paper that we worked on, first of all, in 2003, eventually was published in Nature under the name of Rapid Worldwide Depletion of Predatory Fish Communities. But how did the world come to know that paper? What did people call that? What was its message? Anybody remember that? That was just before that.
Yeah.
90% of the big fish are gone. Have any of you heard of that study before? So this was the basis of the paper that came to be known as 90% of the big fish are gone. Now, I just want to take a little bit of time to tell you the behind-the-scenes story about what made it work. Why did this paper capture so many people's imagination? It became very well known, and it continues to this day to have an impact, and I'm just going to walk you through that. What are the ingredients to really being successful in communicating science? First of all, you have to have passion. And Ram had that in spades. He cared deeply about nature. He cared deeply about science, and he cared passionately about truth. When I first met him, I didn't know that he'd been a DFO scientist who had felt that he had to eventually leave when he was unable to communicate the science that he was doing and what was really happening to the cosmos. He said, "I tried to do an honest job with it, but what happened was he was told that he could not only not communicate with the media, he wasn't even allowed to present the papers that blamed everything but overfishing on the collapse of cod at scientific presentations." So for him, that was untenable. He had to go where he could speak freely, and that brought him here to Dalhousie. And so from there, no longer having to tolerate having his papers suppressed within government, he continued to publish in top-tier journals. But even if you are successful in getting into Nature, which is the number one journal in the world in terms of its impact and its prestige, Ram knew that you couldn't just assume that that would be it, because it's like a river flowing by. Every week there's more and more science. But he also knew that that was an opportunity to leverage it. So he said to me, "How do we get the cover?" He didn't want it to be one of many studies. I said, "Well, you know, lots of people think that it's an executive decision on what's the most important study in a paper that gets the cover. But in fact, the best art wins. It's an art department decision. So we have to find the best possible art." So we looked exhaustively for a compelling image that would portray the message of 90% of the big fish are gone. And we found it with this fellow named Norbert Wu, who said, "Okay, I'll let you submit these pictures. And if they're chosen for the cover, I want to be acknowledged." So that was how we got the cover of Nature. It was all, really hard work and just doing. And so this is note to self for young scientists. When you get a paper submitted to Science and Nature, also put in the best possible art and you may find it at the cover as well. It helped that it was a striking result and a simple message that could be summarized into something like 90% of the big fish are gone. But at the beginning, neither Ram nor Boris, who were co-authors on this paper, knew that that would be their message. It took them time to figure that out, and I'll show you that in a second. They thought about who were all the different audiences that they wanted to talk to. And so they really thought, okay, if I'm talking to somebody on the East Coast, I'm going to talk about tuna. I'm going to talk about swordfish. But if I'm in Florida, I'm going to talk about, giant grouper. And so they customized their message to where they were going to. And they also thought about what are different things that resonate with people? How can we make them care? They thought about how to link it. Right, as it turned out, right after the paper came out, there was a big study in the U.S., and it used as its call to action, 90% of the big fish are gone. And so have the United Nations, and so have many, many other studies. It took an incredible amount of hard work. First, I said to Boris, how long was it? He said, yeah, 6 weeks leading up to the paper. It took us to prepare every aspect of trying to communicate this paper. Step one, figure out what you want to say. This is a little tool called the message box. And it helps you take all of that information you know and pare it down. You just do a brain dump on that. But eventually, Ram and Boris decided that this was their key message, that overfishing has removed 90% of the big fish globally. And that would be the main thing that they wanted to convey. And then from there, they would fit in the other message as much as they possibly could. They built a website that was one-stop shopping for journalists and for anybody who's interested. It had all the background visual materials. It had data if you were a scientist and you wanted to find out more. And we even exhaustively went after pictures that reminded people of what it used to really be like, going after the sense of loss and nostalgia. So Ernest, Hemingway, the old men and the sea, and pictures of just, what used to be there. And this really resonated with people. So it was the combination of all these things together that resulted in, on the day of its publication in May of 2003, this tidal wave of media coverage and discussion and debate. It was above the fold on all of the main papers around the world, on hundreds of television stations in the evening news, and broadcast far and wide by radio. And, I think probably nobody was surprised, as we were. Ramster turned and said, no, it's kind of like NASA. And you really know that you've got your message across and you start seeing it coming up in cartoons. You really penetrated social consciousness. And that was happening everywhere. People were talking about it over dinner. You know that 90% of the big fish are gone. And what this led to was Senator John McCain, who was head of the Resources Committee in the U.S., inviting Ram and Boris to come to the U.S. because they said they'd heard about all this media coverage and they needed to know more about it. So the three of us all went to Washington, D.C. And Ram and Boris went in and they talked to Senator McCain and everybody else who was in the Resources Committee, telling them about their study, about what needed to be done in my family. And maybe nothing changed the next day, but that planted seeds that continue to germinate to this day. I think one of the things that Ram got the biggest kick out of was when he was listed a couple of years later in Fortune magazine as 10 people to watch in the days ahead. And the other person who was right next to him in the article was none other than a senator from Illinois, Barack Obama. Ram would really enjoy that now, knowing all these things that have come to pass. And just 2 nights ago, I was driving home late from work. And it was one of those, listening to radio in late at night. I was listening to National Public Radio. And there was this absolutely fascinating interview with this woman who's very well known around the world. I think less well Canada. Her name is Maya Lin. Have any of you heard of her? She first became really well known because when she was only 21 years old, there was a call worldwide for people to come up with an idea for the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. And it was a blind competition. And she entered her idea, and she was 21, she was still an undergraduate, and it was chosen from all of the heavy-hitting top architects around the world for this. Well, if you look her up on Wikipedia, she has a fascinating life story. But now, what she has decided is that her life's passion is to bring awareness to the world of what we're losing in biodiversity. She has this exhibit, multidimensional, that is touring the world in museums, and it's called What is Missing? And as I was driving along at night, listening to her interview, she said, 90% of the big fish are gone. And she talked about how that had moved her so deeply. But that she had learned that with marine protected areas, fish could come back, so there was hope, and that this was going to be what she dedicated the rest of her life to. And I thought, oh, if only Rand could hear this interview. He's gone across sciences into art, and here's someone else who has incredible reach and power, who's carrying his message forward and wanting to make a difference. So why should scientists be the messenger? I mean, isn't it enough just to do the heavy work of asking those research questions and then the incredibly, you know, laborious effort of collecting the data, and if you're, you know, successful at the end, publishing those findings? Well, that's the way it used to be. You know, that's when your job was done. That was everything that you were evaluated on. But the world is changing. And increasingly, the world needs and relies on scientists to take the next step. If we really want the world to change, we can't keep all that knowledge locked up in the ivory tower or wasting away on dusty shelves or in the literature. That's why communicating with the media is such a powerful way to get the word out, because the media are gatekeepers. They're the entree to all these other audiences that have influence. And the point of all this is that at the end of the day, when you can get people's awareness to a certain point, there's a tipping point where actually there's a policy change. And ultimately, that is what we really need, is for policy to be feeding back to science, for science to be paying attention to policy and framing questions, so that we don't run into this problem that Isaac Asimov says, which is that the saddest thing about society today is that science gathers knowledge faster than society gains wisdom. We need to make that a tighter connection. And just in the last few days, there's been a very inspiring development. Julia Wong worked, one of the students, she's at the back there, with her new baby, worked with Graham Myers on a shark study. And Julia, you must have heard that the presidents of Honduras and Palau have declared at the beginning, they announced this at the beginning of the United Nations meeting, no fishing of sharks in their waters, and they're calling on the rest of the world to protect sharks, stop fishing them, to give them a chance to recover. That's another thing that we made Rand very, very happy. Jane Lubchenco is a marine ecologist who is now the chief administrator for NOAA, which is the equivalent of the Department of Fisheries and Oceans in the U.S. And she was also the person who started this whole program called the Leopold Leadership Program that I've worked on for the last 10 years, training scientists so that more and more scientists will come forward, start to communicate their science, shift the culture, and move society ahead. She said, decisions are going to take into account a number of things, values, politics, economics, but science should be at the table in a way that is understandable and relevant and credible and salient. And she really put her money where her mouth is. I mean, she would probably much rather still be, you know, poking through the tide pools, but she's right in the fray right now, fighting these battles and passionately as well working to really affect change. And she, like Rand, has many, many students coming up behind her who are working very hard to make these shifts. How many people in this room are scientists? Wow. Okay. So some of you might think, I can't do this, it's not for me. Well, what I've learned from working with scientists is that you never know who can, who are going to be the people who really are the stars. Because it's simply a matter of learning a new methodology and applying it. And it's like haiku. It's a lifelong endeavor to get better and better and better at it. I'm going to show you a little clip of a scientist who I worked with at the very beginning at the Old Leopold program. And she was talking about why she had come to the Leopold program. It was because she had hope, fear, and apprehension about being a messenger of her science. And you will see what persistence and perseverance can do over the course of time. She recently had a policy forum that came out about mountaintop mining consequences. And there are policy forums every week in science. But because she worked at communicating it, it became a big deal. But who would have thought that when she first signed up for the Leopold program almost 10 years ago?
Anti-mountaintop removal, but let's face facts, these mountains will grow back.
Actually, these mountains are 300 million years old. And even if the mountains grow back...
They'll grow back in another 300 million years.
Guess what? While those mountains are growing back, we've got all sorts of toxic chemicals that are going into the stream.
Like what? Like toxic chemicals in what streams?
Like,
which will you know?
All sorts of things, like selenium, manganese, these things.
You know that you pay for mineral supplements like manganese and selenium? We're giving them to these people for free. So you say the streams are poison.
Let me tell you, you don't want to be drinking water from these streams. Fish sometimes have two eyes on one side of the head. I haven't seen too many flounders in the streams of West Virginia.
A mountain flounder. Well, then why don't we just take big Brita filters and put them at the mouth of that stream? Have you even thought about that?
It is interesting to ask why the water's not cleaned up, but one thing is that, you know, you can do this in a way that doesn't block mountains. They're more efficient. Well, not necessarily efficient in terms of making money.
So you don't think we should be taking up the top of mountains? You think there's a better way?
I think there's a better way.
We'll take up the bottom of mountains. You realize that's dangerous. That's dangerous.
And in fact, if you do it some of the more traditional ways, more miners will be employed. They're incredibly important to the United States. Coal is important to the United States right now.
Absolutely. It is our alternative energy. Clean coal. Right?
Until we get...
We have a lot of coal. We're the Saudi Arabia of coal.
Until we get to a more sustainable form of energy, we do need coal in this country, and the miners play an important role. What we don't need is people that are having significant health problems in these areas around surface mining. We're talking higher rates of kidney disease, cardiovascular disease, lung cancer. In fact, if you look at the mortality rate in regions of the Appalachians, mortality goes up as a function of the amount of mining that goes on in the county.
So
and it's
not
just miners, it's children and women.
Okay, oh, you're going to play the children and women card. Okay, but you say the people who live in these areas are getting these diseases.
Absolutely.
Okay,
there's
but if you keep removing the mountains, eventually these areas won't be there either, and then you'll be living there, the problem kind of solves itself. And let me ask you this, all right? If we didn't blow up these mountains, don't you think these mountains would just as easily blow us up? Have you heard of Vesuvius or Pinatubo or Mount St. Helens? Payback is a bitch, baby. This is our turn.
Okay, she gets a 10 out of 10 for guts. But you know, maybe you never want to even entertain such a thing. But that's the ultimate test, going up against somebody like Colbert. And she probably has a lot of people thinking about these issues, people who would never otherwise encounter them in any other way. So, there is really something to be said about thinking about talking to media, whether it's your local media, whether it's at the national level, and find your fit. But they are the gatekeepers, they set the agenda, and even in this changing world of new media, policymakers are paying attention to what's in the news. And this is a very timely issue right now because despite the fact that a lot of people are stepping up to the plate, in Canada, in some ways, things haven't changed so much. There's still this problem for government scientists, where the word has gotten out that they aren't free to speak, that they have to go through these filters. And it's interesting that this article that came out recently quotes Andrew Weaver, who was the first speaker at the RAND Memorial Series in Science Society, saying that the public has a right to know what federal scientists are discovering and learning. And here's your own Jeff Hutchins talking about the importance of society being better served by, that you cannot say that society is better served by having these filters and the need for scientists to speak up. So my message is that this is the role of academic scientists. You've got this, you have the freedom, you have, that's why RAND came to Dalhousie in the first place, is you can speak what you know your science is saying. And I see some real causes for hope. How many of you heard about this paper that came out not so long ago about oil sands and the tar sands polluting the Athabasca River? And this is Daniel, sorry, Daniel's the son who I wrote, this is David Schindler, his father. And what was fascinating was that, in fact, the premier came out and said, I respect the scientist, I respect his science, and if it means we have to do something more, we will. He's on the record for saying that. So this was an academic scientist who came out, who spoke to the science of what I was telling him. So there are obstacles. Government is restrained still, so we need academics to speak out. And we need the public to support the importance of scientists speaking out. Often there's a perceived lack of relevance, and so scientists need to work on how do you provide the context and the content and answer the question so well. And my book is really a how-to guide for scientists to develop the skills to do these things. And you need scientific communicators who are the scientists themselves who are closest to the work, who translate it to make sure it's really being accurately conveyed and communicated. Now, I'm not going to be a Pollyanna and pretend that there aren't risks associated with being a scientific communicator as a scientist. And that often, the bigger the splash, the bigger the backlash. And I know that RAND experienced this, and I know that many others have experienced it. And it's particularly risky if you're a young scientist. I'm going to tell you a story. Well, first I want to give you this little... I think this is true, and certainly this is something that many of you who've been at this for a long time know, that there are stages to new science. The first reaction is often, it's worthless nonsense. And then there's a softening, it's interesting but perverse. Then it's true but not so important. And then finally, well, that was this. A young scientist named Martin Perkosik, he was at the University of Alberta, did his work on the coast of British Columbia. And he was fascinated in answering the question, was there an issue with disease transfer between farm fish and wild salmon? And he did a series of three papers. It was remarkable. In the course of 3 years, he published in three of the top tier journals. And the last paper that he did in science, RAND Services, again, is actually one of the co-authors on this paper, as well as Jen Ford, who's also from Dalhousie. Is Jen here today? Oh, I did. We spoke on the phone. Remember all the pressure the torment, the tension of doing this. You were taking risks. Brown wasn't around to take the bullets for you. And Marty Krakowski took a lot of risks. But he found himself in this situation. All he really wanted to do was the research. But there were vested interests. He didn't like the results. And so, as a result, name-throwing starts, junk science is the term that is used by people who have vested interests in not having the science community. There's a great proverb I love that says, you cannot wake a man who's pretending to sleep. And this is what you run into when you're trying to communicate science or you're running up against, industry, for example. But Martin and Jim persevered in communicating what their research was showing them. And they did a very good job of communicating and worked really hard to do it and to make sure that they were absolutely accurate. They too developed an incredibly elaborate website where every criticism was refuted on the basis of the data, of going through it systematically and showing why the data were correct and why the conclusions were accurate. Again, it was becoming such a hot topic. It was, cartoonists were conveying the messages in the paper that showed that, in fact, there was a very serious impact on the pink salmon of the Broad Archipelago that showed that entire populations were being affected as they swam past the fish farms near the mouths of the rivers, and the sea lefts were being transferred to them. And this sort of summed up the whole problem in this little cartoon here. Well, eventually, there was progress made on this. In fact, there was a shift in policy. The environment minister said that he was going to place a moratorium on the development of further fish farms in northern British Columbia. And that was a huge, huge win for all of the blood, sweat, and tears. Here's Marty. I've been wondering if all the outreach was worth it as it consumed so much time, ate me up with stress, and dragged me through the mud during the backlash. Now I see that it was. But the continuation of that story is, he was still a PhD student, now he's finished, and he's looking for a job in an academic institution. But what he really wanted was to stay and work in British Columbia, so he continued on his work at the sea levels. But it was the one position that he was not offered, although many, many others vied for him. Now, whether or not the fact that he was an outspoken person for his science was the ultimate determining factor, no one could say for sure. There's no, how can you actually provide that evidence? But I think that Marty feels that that certainly had an effect because he had every other offer going after, and he's just starting now at the University of Otago. So I just sent him an email. I asked, so now what do you think? This is just a couple of days ago. He said, I've been thinking lots about the work we did and whether it's appropriate for students to do so. Certainly if they do, then having strong support and guidance from senior scientists is a must. I think that's really true. So as a young scientist, my advice to you is, if you want to be a communicator, don't just look at your advisor's publishing record. Make sure that their values align with yours. Look at whether or not there's somebody who's going to support your dreams. And certainly that was something that Graham did. He was, a huge support and nurturer of the students. And I know many other scientists who are doing this. And if you ever want names of, places and institutions, if you're a young scientist, talk to me. Larry Crowder at Duke University. He says, it's like triple word count in Scrabble. When you can do good scientist, and you can communicate it to the media, and you see public, policy take a shift, that's the triple-headed win. And he drags the students everywhere to testify, to see him in action, and to work with him. And, that is kind of like the new way that things are going. And Dalhousie's been very supportive. Forrest is an example of that. I mean, it's not because he was a good communicator that he is a tenured professor now, having been a postdoc with Brown, but it certainly was something that has been supported, the fact that he has chosen to continue to be a very powerful and eloquent spokesperson for science. I know many of you in this room fall into that category, including Julia Wong, who's at the back right now and actually has, for the moment, has landed at NC's Memorial, so I get to see her on a daily basis in Santa Barbara when she's there, and who's now eventually going to be going to the University of Victoria. Okay, so what about for senior scientists? I think it's really important that you work within your institution to make that cultural shift and think about how are the rewards for academia going to include the fact that you're a communicator. And that it's not just about, you know, the number of papers, that it's not just about the number of students that you take on, that there is this whole science and society dimension to things. Another Leopold Fellow is a Canadian named Rashid Sumela. He's now the director of fisheries at the UBC Fisheries Center in Vancouver, UBC. And he says, this was something he said while we were at an all-Leopold leadership training workshop, and everybody was anguishing about, you know, what is advocacy, what is appropriate for scientists, what is the proper role, what should scientists do, is it too risky? And Rashid said, academics are probably the most protected group in the world, yet there is so much fear. Think of other sectors that don't have this protection, yet still they stick their necks out. We're public servants when it comes down to it. And the main reason we have tenure is to protect us from our colleagues. So we need to take advantage of that and get out there. So Ram, it was actually, I think in some ways, never a question for Ram that he had to do this. It, to him, it was just, you know, a moral imperative. And when he was with us, he would come and talk to groups of scientists, often with me, and talk about why he felt it was so important to be engaged in change, and he had what I call Ram's rules. What he called it was his 11-step plan on reaching the heart in mathematics. Okay, so step one, ignition. Something happens in your life that makes you decide you have to do something. Maybe it's the thing you've been spending all your life is in trouble and you can't bear it anymore. You have to decide that, you know, you're going to actually let people know about it. For Ram, it was God. And what he said was, first you get mad as heck. And I said, okay, ignition. Two, you have to decide that even if it means that you get some blowback from your colleagues, that you have to have the courage and independence to lead the path. But it's not easy. We're a tribal species, and anyone who believes that thinking independently is easy has simply never tried it. Persistence. You have to be relentless, that Marty Krakosik was. You know, you have to keep saying the same thing over and over and over again. As Rand said, it's not just talking. By action, I don't mean just mouthing off, but a long, hard, sustained effort. And that step four is that you have to be true to the data, and that the data are what matters. The fact that 100 entrenched scientists say you're wrong is simply not information unless they have the data. And so this was what Graham was doing when I first heard about his talking gate. He was going out to conferences, showing his results before he even published them, so that if people had objections with them, they could try to poke holes in it, and then he would consider their arguments. But if they couldn't back it up, if it was just opinion, or they said, well, no, that's not what I say, he would press on. And he for that paper, Nitrogen and the Big Fish are gone, virtually every tuna billfish biologist saw that paper before it was published. And he still wasn't convinced that anything that they came up with refuted it. Now, in fact, That paper catalyzed many other papers, which was a good thing. When people didn't agree, they could go and actually do the science. That's how science moves ahead. So that's another reason. Even if you only care about the science, if you get the word out there, more people are going to work on your problem, even if it's just because it, you know, it made them mad and move it forward. Now, step five was not something that Brown was always determined to do that. So I'm using Morris as an example for this one. Embrace criticism. I value thoughtful criticism more than anything else. It makes everyone think more deeply and makes us push harder against the limits of being known. Forbes, I think, has been very successful in taking his critics and actually saying, well, let's, he says, when you actually talk face to face with somebody, things get reasonable very quickly. And sometimes what happens is that we think that we have a real, a difference of opinion, but people just don't even talk about it. Now, Rand loved a good fight. One conference I was at, where the billfish scientists were going after him, there was it was a census in room 1-3, and the guy who was organizing me said, "Come on, you guys, stop taking pot shots at each other. If you really want to argue against, Rand's paper, you'll each have 5 minutes to present your case." And so everybody took the time out. Everybody was there, just really excited to see what's going to happen. Rand's at the front of the room. He says, "Can you call out my presentation? It's one that says, it's called, I'm right." That was like classic Rand. Once you have the data, he was going to stick to it. But he would change if you had the data. Build a team. You can't do this work by yourself. And Brown, this very talk this evening is a testament to that. Brown's family is here, Rita, his children, some of them, and students. And today I had the pleasure of having lunch with Rita, and Boris asked Rita, "Did you mind that Boris was, that Brown was always dragging people home for lunch and, not necessarily telling you?" And Rita said, "No, I enjoyed it. That was Ram. That was how I knew what he was up to and what people were doing." And so it was this marriage between his family and his team that was one of the things that, made those who know him love him so much. And, when I first meet Ram, I really couldn't wait to meet Rita, because every time he referred to her, he always said, "My lovely wife." And then I found him there and saw how true that was. 5. If you're doing work that you know is going to push against conventional wisdom or what we've known before, you better prepare for the controversy ahead of time. Anticipate what the arguments are going to be, and by sharing your science widely, that's how you will know where people are going to contest you on it. And then think about how you can actually address some of those concerns from the get-go. Use that criticism to refine your messages. And also alert your colleagues ahead of time so they know that it's in the pipeline, so that they can, those who you know where they stand, you know if they're going to agree or disagree. And that will really help carry the message through more clearly. And Ram said, "Don't worry if people are mad at you. Don't rub it in if they're wrong. Simply produce so much evidence that your naysayers will eventually say that they believe you're all along." And it's so important that you just keep thinking about it, connecting. How do you take, what are the opportunities to talk to various audiences so that you really see your science have that impact on society, so that our policies become more connected to what the science tells us is true? And Brown was fearless. And many scientists I know are who decide that they're going to take up, the risks of being a scientist community. And I think this is one of the biggest things that really motivated Brown, is that he just plain cared. Because he loved his family so much. And he passionately wanted a world where there were still sharks. And, at this point, I think we actually have some hope. We see some really positive changes in that direction. That would make Brown happy. So this was one of Rand's slides from his talk, and it's Rand's quotes. Political action is costly for any scientist. However, it also has great benefits. To act is to live, to be suppressed is to die. What inspires me today is so many scientists, young and old, are deciding to take the risks and to communicate their science. And so for this lecture, I actually went around and I asked just a sampling of scientists why they bother to communicate their science. And you may recognize a few people here, you may not, but the point is, this is a growing notion.
You want to die with a whole lot of knowledge and nobody else knows? You have to tell people what you thought.
Personally, I see education outreach as just sort of part of the job. And I don't mean that as in my job description as a tenure track faculty at university, but that it's just in our sort of greater sort of responsibility as scientists. I mean, we're in a fight because we want to change how things happen. We want to have an impact. And it's the other scientists are not your major audience for a lot of our work. It's policymakers and legislators, et cetera. And so if you want to change how the world works, you've got to engage in it.
To some extent, I am an advocate for Carl Reese, and I don't really feel any conflict between that and being a good scientist. There's an imperative to improve the management of coral reefs, and that can only be done through improved scientific knowledge, but we've got to communicate that knowledge to policymakers and to the public at large. So I don't see a conflict between being a good scientist and being a spokesperson for whatever issue you're interested in.
I have what I call my three no-dies, a biblical job for me. And the first one is know thy audience. Start where they are, not where you are, and then bring them where you are. The second one is know thyself. Don't put yourself in a situation you can't handle, or go beyond your knowledge just to say something cute, or tell them the policy you're in favor without having thought carefully about what's wrong with it or what's right with the other one. And the third one, especially for academics, is know thyself. Try to talk about something you really have competence in, because when you have competence, you're much more likely to have confidence.
I don't think you can communicate well if you're not comfortable communicating. But there's so many different ways of communicating that the most important thing is to find that way that one most enjoys and feels best about, and then doing that.
So it's not the critic who counts. You're the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who's actually in the arena. And my conclusion is that society really needs scientists to speak out, because the data don't speak for themselves. So I'd like to thank you for joining me tonight. I hope that some of this has seeded some thoughts. You know, the way that you choose to speak out doesn't have to be through the media. It can be just by engaging with the community, working with schools and students. But look at what fit is for you, because the world needs you badly. And you can be part of this growing movement that I think will accelerate us moving in the right directions. That's the formal conclusion of what I wanted to share with you today. But I wanted to end with a little, not a little, it's a short, but I think profound tribute to Rand, to just remind us of what an inspiration has been to so many of us.
This was a guy who didn't walk, he ran, he sprinted, he jumped.
job.
A very frenetic individual, very intelligent. Ram is extremely good at taking his work on conservation biology of marine fishes and the declines that many large fish were experiencing and communicating that to the public and to the media.
The Department of Fisheries Ocean was claiming, and it was an attempt to bureaucratically enforce a scientific position, that is, that the cod stocks were increasing by great leaps and bounds, that the mortality due to fishing was low, and it simply was not so.
Whether it's bureaucrats, politicians, scientists, everyone's always measuring their words. But there comes a point, I mean, the patterns are so obvious, and the consequences are so important, that you've got to express them strongly, or your voice won't be heard, and the results of that work won't be known.
Research of mine was censored, and this was not an uncommon position for the Department of Fisheries and Oceans and upper-level bureaucrats to take.
He was ultimately really happy in his work, I think, because he totally believed in what he was doing. Ram was not a guy that was really easily let something conquer him. He was really the guy to chase after things and make things happen.
To take drastic action would require enormous courage, would require enormous trouble. You might miss your ski vacation.
There's no question the family actually really did come first.
He actually encouraged me to have kids during my graduate program. He wanted to make sure that all the students could enjoy the other side of life as well.
Questioning, gathering information, proper analysis, and then communicating the results of the work, that whole package and the intensity and the emotion that he clearly felt about it, that has to be the sort of legacy that any scientist would want.
Thank you, Nancy. We have a few minutes for questions. If you want, there's microphones on the floor, so please come ahead.
I was interested in your comment that young scientists should seek someone who shares their values when they're looking for a supervisor. And I wonder whether you could comment more on what you mean there, because I think that there's a danger and looking for somebody who shares necessarily your political or societal values. One of the best mentors for me was a gun-carrying, motorcycle-riding, righteous, fantastic science communicator. And he inspired me. I didn't share his politics or something.
And I don't mean politics when I say values. I guess what I mean is that one of the things I look for is when we get in trouble with people when you're not clear about your expectations. And so I think for young students, it's important if you think you, and many young, I get so many young scientists who come to me and say, I want to make a difference in the world, how do I do this? Well, you need somebody who's going to support you in doing this. And I think you need somebody who's receptive to the idea that it's important to communicate science. And so, as a young scientist, I mean, you don't want to get out there and stick your neck out too far, too soon. You need to have the credibility. But I do think it's important to, if you're somebody like a Marty Perkosik, to have a supervisor who is going to protect you and encourage you if you find that your science takes you into a place where suddenly your science becomes controversial. But I'm not saying that you have to have aligned values in every step. What I really mean is that some, if you think it's important to communicate your science, that you're able to say to that person, how do you feel about this? This is something where, not today, where I won't necessarily be doing this, but down the road, I won't be heading in that direction. How do you feel about this? Would you be comfortable with that?
There's another question. Anyone?
I'm just one issue that I've had some problems with is how scientists sometimes don't seem to anticipate the policy implications of the work, and so they they look at an issue just from the science point of view, which means you're very conservative. You know, you do not want to say something that you can't absolutely prove. But when it comes to the policy, you have to be a bit more precautionary. And how do you anticipate or, you know, figure out how your work can be misconstrued, and how you can you prevent that ahead of time by how you present it?
It's a tough one because a big part of the issue is that traditionally science is isolated from what's going on in policy, and scientists aren't provided the skills to be communicators. It's not part of what you do as you go through academia. But increasingly, there are programs now where becoming connected to policy, learning the basic tools of communication are part of the package. That doesn't help you when you're at the point where you are. And I really think it's a matter of reaching out to people who do have experience, have run into these things, that can advise you ahead of time, so you're proactive, you think about it. You do the, you know, ask somebody who knows somebody else to help you think it through, maybe broker some connections. And it often really helps to do the front-end work where you have conversations ahead of time with people so they know it's coming and you can actually build support and make those connections ahead of time so it's not such a random occurrence when it comes out. But it's tough. And I hear you. We talked a little bit after the seminar that, you know, it's very common to get a lot of backlash. And that's why you need a community. And that's a big part of this, is finding the community, finding the support networks in your colleagues and in your families. You can't do it alone. It's impossible, unsustainable.
One last question, Bob.
Digesting your talk earlier, I was digesting your message and that was pretty good. It seems that much of the way this is discussed, is in terms of framing a message and making, you know, it relevant to people. I think also, is there an aspect of communicating science that can maybe get the wider world to think a little bit more scientifically, to think about what constitutes evidence in favor of a position, or is it more vague, or is it all, you know, we try to do that even in our second and third year classes, you know, the idea of getting the reading the paper, I think, in terms of hypotheses and evidence, is that hopeless?
I don't think it is hopeless. I think it's, you know, we've got a long way to go, but I know scientists who actually go into groups of naysayers. Steve Schneider, a climate scientist, who died not long ago, would go into groups of communities of people who did not believe in climate change. And what was really powerful to me was to see that a lot of the people who were the naysayers were really concerned about this as well. They could be convinced with a really clear communication of the science and if treated respectfully and having their questions answered were convincible. And very often, people who are most vehemently opposed to something are the people who are really deeply most concerned about it and are actually most susceptible to having their minds changed. So I do think it's a drip, drip, drip sort of thing, well, you know, where every scientist has to look at his opportunities to be talking to more people. And, you know, whether it's the person you're sitting next to on the plane, or, you know, talking about your kids, you know, class or this community event, it's a slow turnaround, and it's not going to happen overnight.